and gentlemen, welcome to this talk this afternoon. At a talk given by Professor Theodore Krauthammer from the University of Florida on March 19th, I think some of you have heard of it. CBS Professor Kwek Fong Woon had a talk heard that Professor Joseph Kaiser had delivered this topic to NPS a month earlier. And CBS asked that this topic be shared among members of the defense community of Singapore. So here we are today. With overwhelming subscription, we have 76 persons who registered with us. Some have not turned up, I think probably held up the weather. So Joe went on very diligently from last month to upgrade this talk that he delivered to NPS a month earlier. So today we're going to go through quite a thick presentation, 89 slides to be precise. Alright, Joe?
Yeah,
in 10 minutes. That's rapid assistance engineering. So he has spiced up some of the slides, and there's one slide that has a local context of Singapore. So we'll try and spot it if you can, somewhere in the middle of your presentation. And this topic may sound quite controversial. The Seldon crisis. So if you see it as a controversy, well and good, because we hope that you can stir up a very healthy and vibrant discussion in the QAS session. This talk is jointly organized by TASI and the Tin Boon in one chapter, because the core issue is systems engineering, and the main cause of the systems going. So Joe here is a well-known figure, Joe Kassler, in the systems engineering community. Yes. Spurred us on way back in 2006 to organize the first Asia Pacific Conference of Systems Engineering that was held in March 2007. And now he continues to serve in the host committee of the ECOSI International Symposium that will be held in Singapore from 20th to 21st July this year. And we hope you can sign up. We have flyers on this forthcoming International Symposium. We'll pass it around at some point. On the way up to the table outside as well, so pick up and share and help us publicize it. The background of Joe, as you've seen in the synopsis that I sent out, I will not repeat the whole thing, but he has, just briefly to mention, that he has over 35 years of systems engineering practice, both in academic work and especially for in the industry as well. He has worked at NASA. He is an ECOSI fellow and he has published two books. A book called The Framework for Understanding Systems Engineering, and the other book is Applying Total Quality Management to Systems Engineering. And of course, he has also written many papers. He is now a visiting professor at the Division of Engineering and Technology Management in the Faculty of Engineering. Very fortunate to have him here. He's been with us for half a year now and has shared much of his views and knowledge of systems engineering for the benefit of all of us. So here we are. Let's hear from Joe Kaiser, the topic, the Seldon crisis in systems engineering. So,
thank you. And thank you for coming and braving the rain. What I'm going to talk about is I'm going to look at systems engineering from different perspectives: management, education, and you'll see. Okay. These things always work a lot better when you turn them on. What I'm going to talk about today is the Seldon crisis, the fact that the systems approach is the current way to tackle major problems, and I'm going to tell you what Seldon crisis of systems engineering is facing, observations on systems engineering, history and evolution of systems engineering, and some recommendations. Now, my format will be to ask questions as I go along. And these are rhetorical questions, so they're there to make you think, not to answer. and we'll take questions and have a discussion at the end, simply for timekeeping. Now, if something I say makes you so excited or so angry or something, you really have to ask the question or interrupt. Don't. Just write it down and say it. Definition of the Seldon crisis. Seldon crisis was introduced by Isaac Asimov in one of his book, Foundation Series books. It's a crisis that involves both an external pressure and an internal pressure. Both come to head simultaneously, and both can be resolved with the same action. Now, the good news about systems engineering is the systems approach has been perceived as the way to tackle the problems that we're facing. And it's produced an unprecedented demand for systems engineers. The demand transcends nations, types of systems, and universities all over the world are busy turning out systems engineers because there's an awful lot of them. And systems engineering still has a load of credibility. I'm not sure why, but it does. Now, I've told you that systems engineering has a lot of credibility, and all of a sudden I'm saying now that within 1 to 5 years, the current international support in government and industry for systems engineering will probably begin to wane. Why? Because the cost and schedule overruns that we're seeing will continue. And once the support begins to wane, systems engineering will just disappear, like total quality management, business process re-engineering. The academic institution enrollments in systems engineering go down. So how many people here teach systems engineering? And you still want a job in 5 years? You've got to do something about it. How many of you are studying systems engineering? So you're studying something that might not exist in 5 years. Wait a minute, we need to do something about that.
But you think you're winning, is it because it seems not to be effective?
I'm going to explain that.
Okay.
Right. One of the wonderful things about making a prediction like this is if it happens, then I'm wonderful because I predicted it. If it doesn't happen, I'm also wonderful because I prevented it. And when I was sort of researching this, I looked up I wanted to find out what the US government thought a systems engineer did. So I went to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, I looked up systems engineering, I couldn't find it. Now, internally, inside systems engineering, we have a lack of consensus on what systems engineering is. We don't have a body of knowledge. We're having difficulty differentiating it as a profession, and we're making things too complicated. And I'm going to go into some of these details. Now, how did I discover this? Well, I've been doing research since 1995. I went to my first international symposium on systems engineering in 1995. I mean, I'd been working in systems engineering for 25 years before that, but it was the first time I heard about NCOSI, and I was encouraged to go. And I figured I'd learn what systems engineering was. Well, every session I sat through, the presenter stood up and defined systems engineering. And you know something? Every definition was different. And then they went on and they described what systems engineers did. They talked about planning, organizing, controlling, staffing. Well, if any of you have a management background, it's what managers do. So wait a minute. What do systems engineers really do? So I started researching it. And to cut a long story short, I ended up creating the world's first immersion course in systems engineering at Cranfield University a year or so ago. And I had to do a lot of research and work to
to sort of actually create the course. And I've been here for 6 months working on creating a master's degree. So some of my observations can be summarized. Systems engineering is poorly practiced in general. And I've got some data from the US on that, and I'll show you in a moment. It's poorly taught in general. There's no universally accepted definition and body of knowledge. There's no universal agreement on the role. Back in the 1950s and 60s, if you read the textbooks, it tells you systems engineering will solve the complex problems that we're facing today. They wrote that 50 years ago, and if you read the textbooks of today, what are they saying? Same thing. So in 50 years, systems engineering hasn't met its promises. There's an overlap with other professions, especially project management. What's the overlap? And then when you look at system of systems and complex systems, there's a dichotomy. There are two camps. First camp says, wow, this is something new, we have to work at it, we have to develop new tools because we have no idea what to do. Second camp says, what's the problem? We've done it. And then you see this growing demand for certification of competencies in COSI, CISA, whatever. To me, that's a red flag. Because if governments and companies, employers, are looking for certification of competency, there must be an awful lot of lack of competency about. And there are no approved standards or standards for systems engineering. Poorly practiced. Inadequate systems engineering in the early design and definition phase has been a cause of major program failures. Poor systems engineering. The definition linkage between escalating costs and the ineffective application of systems engineering. And where some of this research material is on the internet, I've left hot links in on the handout that you can get by email, so you can check the source yourself. Poorly practiced. Here's another one. GAO report in 2006. All these fails. But they didn't have to, because in 2001, I predicted the JSF would fail. Now, if you're going to predict something is going to fail, what you do is you publish it in an obscure symposium that nobody attends. So that in the event the prediction comes true, you can point to it, and if the event the prediction doesn't come through, nobody knows about it. So, let's take a look. A master's degree. A master's degree is a man-made system. A man-made system is a solution to a problem. And actually, we produce a system to requirements. So I ask academics two simple questions. First question, what are the requirements to which your degree was designed to meet? The answer I typically get is, huh? What? Except in two instances. Naval Postgraduate School had a set of requirements from the Navy, and University of Missouri, Missouri Science and Technology, had a set of requirements from Boeing. But the otherwise, and then I asked, how do you show that the degree meet the requirements? And the response in general is student evaluations. Well, with all due respect to the students in here, students can evaluate that the knowledge was taught right. They can't evaluate that if they were taught the right knowledge. So when I sort of take a look at the master's degrees, and this is a summary of my benchmarking, the knowledge component seems to be, they teach a little bit about the systems engineering process, a little bit about requirements, a little bit about architecting, and then the remainder varies according to the institution. And if I'll say it less politely, it's basically whatever the faculty can teach, we bundle that up and produce and call it a degree in systems engineering. We're also teaching a cookbook approach. We're not teaching an understanding of the basics. And we're missing critical parts. The skills component is difficult to determine. So as a result, The students graduate with different knowledge and skills from each institution, which reinforces the need for standards and a body of knowledge. When I say it's poorly taught, we generally focus on what's easy to teach. And I'm just as guilty of this as everybody else, as I'm finding out. We teach parts without relating to them. So students learn if you go how to go from A to B, C to D, E to F, but they have no understanding of the whole picture. We show relationships, but we don't go into details. We teach what, but not how. We don't teach the basic building blocks of solutions. How many people understood that statement? Obviously, you didn't learn it, because we don't teach it. We ignore gaps. We teach things that are not representative of reality, and I'll show you some of these. We ignore the paradigm of change. We talk about get all the requirements up front. You can't get all the requirements up front. There are two types of requirements. There's the set you should get up front, which is everything that the customer wants at the time the contract is given or at the time the need is established. But then there's another set. Things change over time. Those requirements don't exist at the beginning. You can't get them. You have to learn to deal with them. We don't use optimum pedagogy or technology. And we teach the process of doing it by numbers. We teach declarative and procedural knowledge. And for those of you who don't know what declarative and procedural knowledge are, I stuck this in. Declarative knowledge is knowledge that can be declared in some way. It's knowing that something is the case. Describing a process is declarative knowledge. Procedural knowledge is knowing how to do something and it must be demonstrated. We do not teach very well conditional knowledge, knowing when and why and to apply the declarative and procedural knowledge. Now, students like declarative and procedural knowledge because when they come to the exams, they're closed answers. So they love these because tell me what I need to give you back on the exam. Great. Conditional knowledge, that's open-ended answers. Give you an example of the type of questions on the exams. Singapore is just, let's say a country, I might say Singapore, sorry. A country has just acquired a new fighter plane. How many people here are in the Air Force? Okay, it's just acquired a new fighter plane. It's got a defect. It's not a major serious one, but it's a defect. Every time you use the ejector seat, it kills the pilot. We've got a budget to fix it for $2.5 million. So we put out a tender and we get back two tenders. First tender, $2 million, 1 year, will save the pilot 50% of the time. Second tender, $3 million, 2 years, will save the pilot 95% of the time. Tender A and tender B. Usual question we ask, which tender do we pick? The question we should be asking is, what additional knowledge do we need to make a choice? See the difference? Because that opens up other aspects. Now, back in 2003, the top five systems engineering issues were number one, number two, number three, insufficient systems engineering tools and environments to effectively execute systems engineering on programs, requirements, and poor initial formulation. I'm going to focus on these two. Number three, insufficient systems engineering tools. Ever heard this? Now, on the subject of systems engineering tools, what are systems engineering tools? Well, back in the 1950s and the 1960s, the tools that systems engineers used were analysis tools. It was all mathematics. So, what would you expect the tools to be in the year 2000? databases, word processors, spreadsheets, and drawing tools. Don't believe me? Go look it up. You can download his presentation. Doesn't that make you ask why? What happened to systems engineering? The tools went from math to dumb computer programs. Now coming back, systems thinking. We don't teach it very well. Until a year and a half ago, this is what I taught. You need to use systems thinking. Everybody says it's important, and it really is. And we teach the history, a bit of philosophy and how it came about. And then we say, well, when you're doing it, you'll know it. And that'll take about 30 years. But there's a gap. In the meantime, we teach a little bit of systems dynamics, a little bit of Checkland soft systems methodology. We show Senge's fifth discipline, and we teach that linear thinking is bad. But it's not in every case. It's only bad in some cases. And then there's this whole slew of vendors out there that tell you, my approach will solve all your problems. We don't teach where, when, and how to apply systems thinking. And if you look at the basic influencing literature on systems thinking, it's coming from operations research, not systems engineering. And I looked up, did a web search on systems thinking in the INCOSI conference, in the INCOSI symposium proceedings, and one of the definitions of systems thinking in there was, think about the life cycle. Don't do it very well. There's no universal body of knowledge. Closest we've got is Stevens produced a reference curriculum for a graduate program in systems engineering. It's not a body of knowledge. A body of knowledge to me is a set of requirements. What they produced was a design. You've got information in the INCOSI publications, in the standards, and in the textbooks. But we're now starting, in the US at least, they're now starting to talk about ABET accreditation of degrees. Well, I ask, if there's no body of knowledge, what objective standards are the degrees going to be accredited against? We're not applying systems engineering to systems engineering. In terms of complex systems, remember I talked about the dichotomy? This is the article that appeared to start the whole thing. It's quoted by everybody. Well, I like to go back and read the original sources. He quotes the Chaos 95 study suggesting systematic reasons for project failures and then suggests it was inherent complexity. It's not true. The study says the failure was not complexity, it was poor management. He quotes his own prior work, for all practical purposes, adequate testing of complex engineering systems is impossible. That's true, but it only applies to the way they're designed today. There are ways to design systems that make them more reliable. We just don't enforce those practices. And he suggests that the evolutionary process for engineering large complex systems is the correct one to use. Well, he's right, but it's not just large complex systems, it's any type of system. Back when I was studying electrical engineering, I was told, build a little Tesla. Well, that's evolutionary acquisition, same thing. Build a little Tesla loop, make sure it does what you want it to do, move on and build the next bit. Nothing new. The subject of complexity. There are two types of complexity. There's the real world complexity that the real world is complex, but when we deal with it, we try and abstract it out and only pick up bits that we need. And then there's artificial complexity that's into elements of the real world that should have been abstracted out when you draw the internal and external system boundaries, because they're not relevant to the problem. And how many people here have heard of Rube Goldberg or Heath Robinson? Shows my age, doesn't it? These people they drew cartoons of very complicated ways of doing simple things. Rube Goldberg was in America and Heath Robinson was in the UK. And let me give you an example. Here's a representation of a system from Rube Goldberg. This is a system for sharpening a pencil. You know how it works? You open the window and you fly the kite. When the kite goes up, string comes down, the door of this cage opens. The moths fly out. They're hungry, they see the jacket, and they start munching away. When they've munched away enough of the jacket, it gets lighter, it goes up, the boot comes down onto this switch, which turns on the electricity, which heats up the iron. The iron generates steam, which goes into the hole in the tree. There's a possum that lives in the hole in the tree. It gets very uncomfortable with steam, so what does it do? It jumps out into the bucket. Well, when it goes into the bucket, down goes the bucket, up goes the cage, the woodpecker sees the pencil and starts to nibble away at the pencil, sharpening it. Now, Ruth was a good systems engineer. He built some risk management into this. If there's no wind, or the string breaks, or the moths aren't hungry, or there's a power failure, or the possum misses the bucket and lands on the floor, he's got this knife hanging here on this chain that you can use to sharpen the pencil. And I think that some of the systems we're building and some of the processes we're using to build the system could be designed by Rube Goldberg. In terms of system of systems, if you go back and look at some of the original texts that introduced the term, you find it was Jackson and Keyes, and it came from operations research, not systems engineering. And he wasn't talking about system of systems the way we think about it today. He was talking about a system of problem-solving methodologies. In other words, for figuring out what's the appropriate tool to use to solve the problem. And then he goes on and says, classification of a system as complex or simple will depend on the user and the purpose he has for considering the system. That's why there are two camps. First group, it's complex because they don't know anything about it. Second group, it's simple because I know how to deal with this one. Systems engineering has been defined by Jenkins as the science of designing complex systems in their totality to ensure that the component subsystems making up the system are designed, fitted together, checked, and operated in the most efficient way. 1969. Well, if you said that then, why do we need complex systems engineering? Isn't that what systems engineering should be about? Well, let's take a look. DoD Guidebook 5000. Successful implementation of a proven discipline systems engineering processes results in a total system solution that is robust, adaptive, and balanced among program budgets. Is this true? Anybody ever heard of garbage in, garbage out? Let's take a look. Systems engineering process in commercial and defense applications is similar because of the common process standards that they share. This is a quote out of a paper that was submitted to the INCOSI symposium. So the question is, what process is documented in the standards? Answer, the systems engineering process. My question, is it? Let's go take a look. First of all, if you go back to 1981, this is the book that educated a generation of systems engineers. And what it discusses is the relationship between functions. This is not a process. But the functions are laid out in an order, but they somehow become a process. But the problem with that is, when you turn a functional view into a process and you show feedback between functions, you also show time running backwards. If this is a process, you can't go back. So we're using poor symbology for discussing processes. We're taking functional drawings and showing them as processes. Let me give you some examples of this. How many people here have not heard of the waterfall approach? Okay. The waterfall approach is a very simple model of things done in steps. It's called the waterfall because it goes down, which I never understood, because every time I've seen a waterfall, it goes straight down. It doesn't go down like that. Anyhow, but it ignores change. Now, the waterfall is a very useful tool when you're planning a series of activities. Step one, step two, step three, step four. But that's the only legitimate use for it. Because what we know that it doesn't work. So as early as 1984, people figured out it didn't work, and so they modify it. Well, if each step takes place in time, if time is moving along like that, we don't yet have the technology to go backwards in time. But it's not really like this. It's like this. When you're thinking about a problem, you sort of think about all sorts of aspects of it. And it gets even worse. It sort of looks like this. So we can't really talk, we shouldn't really talk about the waterfall process. And then when I put this up in the class and I discuss it in class, students all understand it. At least they say they do. But then when they do their assignments and discuss which life cycle they're going to use for one of their projects, students show up that this is the life cycle for their project, which means they don't understand it. It's bad. You need to find better ways of explaining to the students. So waterfall wasn't good, so we introduced spiral. Barry Bean introduced the spiral. Well, all the spiral is mini waterfalls in series. We go around the loop. Each time it's a spiral. And sort of changes in the requirements is sort of incorporated in it, but it's not emphasized. The emphasis is on risk. And there's no system framework at the beginning. But we teach this as a development methodology. It does not include the effect of change. It's wrong. And then we've got the spiral model in the DERA. That's the UK format. Do students really understand this? And then, what are those two blocks? Solution abstraction, solution realization. Where did they come from? Incremental model. Break it up. User requirement, system requirement. Again, no consideration of change. And what's more, they switch the axes. Students are used to seeing time running horizontally. Well, it does. Time runs horizontally and vertically. Not a good approach, but we teach it. Still get the requirements up front. And we talk about concurrent engineering. Well, concurrent engineering is great. It really is good. It makes sure you build the right system. It makes sure you build the system right, but not necessarily the right system, because again, no consideration of change. So the first place where you do actually see some consideration of change is in evolutionary development. But it still doesn't explicitly call out external changes in the needs. These are feedback changes from the use of the system. So it's incomplete. Now, the latest model that you're seeing is the V model. Anybody notice anything about the V model? Let's take a quick look. First of all, what's bad about it? Well, it lacks prevention of defects. What's the definition of a successful test? The definition of a successful test is one that finds a problem. Why is that? Because if the test did not find a problem, you don't know if you've got a good product or a good test. So, the design people should be working from the requirements, the people who are building the test should be working from the need. They identify the probable defects they're going to look for, and they start designing the tests to look for those defects. Wouldn't it be more efficient if once they figure out what defects they're going to look for, they go talk to the developers to make sure that the developers don't produce those defects? If the government's got lots of money, remember, the government is going to pay for those defects to be created and then pay for those defects to be fixed. Great from the contractor's point of view. Not good from the government's point of view. Why can't we prevent the defects? And then, the V model doesn't cope well with change. Let's go back to the waterfall. Let's redraw the waterfall model. we move those up, what do you see? Anybody see a V? The V is not a model. It's a view. It just shows the relationship between development and test, and that's all, that's its purpose. It's a management tool. It's not the development process. And if you go back and look at the original articles, and the students in SDM 5002 were inflicted with those two articles, you see that it's a management tool, it is not a process. So what is the systems engineering process? Well, if you look at the late Brian Maher, he says, most systems engineers accept the following basic core concepts. Understand the problem, translate the problem into measurable requirements, examine the feasible alternatives and pick a solution, and then make sure over the system lifecycle you consider these things and test it before delivering it. And document everything. Well, if that's the process, why is the following graphical model still current? What the RFP described, how the bidder understood it, what was specified, what was designed, what was implemented, what the customer really wanted. Now, I picked that up in 1970, and 40 years later, almost, wow, 40 years later, it still is applicable today. We haven't learned anything in 40 years. Why not? Now, if you take a look, is there anything out there using generic thinking? Is there anything out there that's similar to the systems engineering process? Well, systems engineers deal with problems. Let's go look at the problem-solving process. And I went on the internet and I found two versions of the problem-solving process. Notice the similarity between these and the system, and Brian Maher's systems engineering process? They seem to be identical. The level of details are different because it's broken apart in different ways, but it seems to be a similar thing. So what were they doing? Systems engineering or problem solving? Well, let's go find out. Let's look at the standards. 499, the standard, that's not for systems engineering, it's for systems engineering management. How many people actually look in the standards? We hear about them and we use them, but we don't actually look in them. And then by the time it got to 499A, the word system was dropped. It became engineering management. Wait a minute, what's going on here? 632. It's the process for engineering the system, not for systems engineering. 1220, the management of the systems engineering process. It's not doing systems engineering. 15288, it's the processes. And the other comment I'm going to make about 15288, if you want your standard to be adopted throughout the world, don't charge 168,000 Swiss francs for it. Give it away. What's going on? So, let's now, some of those standards cover common areas and some of them cover different things because they were produced at different times by different people working in different places. So, what would you think the common content would be? Well, let's take a look at committed costs over the life cycle. This is a drawing I pulled. It's in the ENCOSI Systems Engineering Handbook, and it comes out of Defense Acquisition University in 1993. So, where should the focus of the systems engineering standards be? I'll give you a clue. The arrow is pointing to it. Let's take a look from another perspective. Actually, if you look at the standards in chronological order, and I pulled this out of Eric Honor and Ricardo Valerdi's work, and rearranged what they did in the tables, notice that mission purpose definition is missing out of the early standards. And notice how systems architecting is missing. How do we get there? isn't this important to systems engineering? Isn't getting that front end right important to systems engineering? Well, remember this drawing I showed you earlier? Where would you focus the getting it right efforts? If you look at the allocation of costs to this, 70% of the costs are allocated at this point, 85 to 95 are allocated further up the line. Where would you focus? At the front end or at the back end? Let me see some hands. Three possible answers. Don't know, front end or back end. How many people say don't know? One. Fair enough. Two. How many people say front end? How many people say back end? Okay. You seen this drawing? Cost to repair a defect. The later you find the defect, the more it costs to fix it, right? Interesting shape. If you take a look at the degree of micromanagement in the systems engineering standards starting in 1967 with the Air Force manual, MIL standard 499 and DoD 5000R, the degree of micromanagement in the standards is about the same shape. Now, DoD 5000, required systems engineering. Acquisition of programs shall be managed through the application of a systems engineering approach. It emphasized the use of systems engineering. Is that good for systems engineering? Read on. It gutted systems engineering. Let me explain why. It took systems engineering that needs to be done at the front end, it took all the activities that need to be done in the front end out of systems engineering. It called them integrated product process teams and used cost as an independent variable. And yet, when you look at the activities that the teams do, these are the early phase systems engineering activities. So what happened? So it took systems engineering out of the initial program formulation instead of fixing systems engineering. That's all done by the government. And if the government don't do their work well, who gets the blame for it? The contractor. They're in the systems engineering. So our systems engineering standards are focused on the wrong problem. Now, systems engineering is focused on process. If you go back to 1994, this is often quoted for defects and failures in projects. Where does it say systems engineering? Where does it say process? The focus is on people, not on process. And if you look at the literature, the focus is on people, not on process. I read the literature on how to make projects succeed. It doesn't talk about process standards. It talks about people, conditional knowledge, what we're not teaching. Now, if we look at people, there are five types of systems engineer, project management leaders. The lowest one, not the lowest, but you sort of progress through these. Type one is the apprentice, who can be told how to implement a solution and can do it. Type two, who can be told what needs to be done to implement a solution and can work out how to do it. Type three, who can be given the problem and then determine what needs to be done to implement an optimal solution. Type four, who can define the problem. And type five, who can define the problem and then determine what needs to be done to implement the solution. So systems engineers are not interchangeable. There are five different types. Now, when do you need the different types? Well, look at this drawing. I pulled it out of JAXA, Japan Space Agency, and I think I've seen it somewhere else, but I don't remember where. It shows the overlap between systems engineering and project management, in that you've got a lot of systems engineering up front, and then systems engineering pulls away, and then project management comes up. Well, at the beginning, when you're trying to figure out what the problem is and what the solution is and how to design the process to produce the solution, you need your type 4 and 5s. And at the end, when they're sort of building it, you need your type 3s. Well, now let's look at history. What happens is, in the concept study design phase, way back in the 60s, we're working in a single system context, space rockets, moon program, missiles, planes, whatever. The type 4s and 5s identify the real problem. The type 3s and 5s design both the solution system and the implementation process. And by the way, in those days, operations research was a tool used by systems engineers. Remember those tools with all that math? Those maths were grouped together as operations research. On the other hand, if you read some of the operations research literature in those days, systems engineering was a tool used by operations research. They just had a slightly different focus on what they were doing. And then you get to the preliminary design phase. The type 2s implement the solution. The type 3s, 4s, and 5s move on to the next project. And so the rest of the system lifecycle, the type 2s implement the solution. They follow the process that has been designed for them. And the type 3s, 4s, and 5s are available sometimes to help with the problems that come up. Well, when the project sort of faded away and there weren't any new projects, what happened? What happens in the West when you run out of work and lay the people off? So you're left with the type 2s. And the type 2s, particularly the Air Force, write the military standards to document what they're doing. They didn't understand the problem, they weren't dealing with problems, they were processed. So they deal with the process. And the focus changes from a problem focus to document and follow the process. And then what's worse is we teach type 2 systems engineering to the next generation, and it becomes systems engineering. And the potential types 3s, 4s, and 5s, they learn type 2 systems engineering. And even when the US got rid of the mill standards, it didn't change the paradigm. And so the type 4s and 5s are trying to improve the type 2 process paradigm, and it's reached the point of diminishing returns. Now, when does systems engineering work? Well, it worked very well in NASA. Over here you've got the science station the astronauts set up on the moon. At the base of this over here is this plate you can see over here. There isn't a single piece of software in any equipment in that rack before the days of software. But it was still in the days when I had hair. Systems engineering worked very well in Singapore. And PC Louis gave an excellent talk on it about 2 years, almost, just over 2 years ago at the APCOSI conference. Where it didn't work was in the US Air Force. Now, I showed you examples of poor systems engineering from 2003 earlier. Well, I found this book written in 1972 that references the U.S. Congressional Record, and it's saying that back in 1969, 68 systems for $10 billion, and a list of failures. So systems engineering has sort of not really worked in the U.S. Air Force. And guess who the people who wrote the MIL Standard 499 were? U.S. Air Force. So the type 2 systems engineering, the approach, is to start with a process. When the process doesn't work, you add another process. Keep bolting them on as needed. I mean, for example, the classic thing is we've got a process that's producing defects. What do? Do we fix it? No, we put on another process that tests the defects and filters them out. Wait a minute, isn't that wasteful? Shouldn't we be fixing the process? That was the whole concept of TQA. So we have quality assurance, we have risk management, and so on. Follow the process, go by the book, and then institutionalize the process in standards which ties the hands of the people who really know what they're doing because they can't change it. The result, continuing cost and schedule overruns, and we haven't made good on the promises of the 50s and 60s, and we're still using linear representations. We need people who can write the book, not people who go by the book. We need type fives. So then we modify the process in the linear thinking process. We put in new processes for agile, new processes for lean. I mean, agile, that's just shorter waterfalls in series where you examine the changes. You don't need a new process for it. Type 3s, 4s, and 5s, they're locked in the type 2 paradigm. And we get more and more constraints that are written on the solutions. And they're written in solution language. We legislate, we don't educate. Things like C4ISR, LISI, DODAF, and the MODAF. Anybody here heard of the DODAF? We'll come to the DODAF in a minute. And so we're sort of modifying these processes to the point where it gets to be ridiculous. This is a V model, and it's described for agile systems engineering. Streamline acquisition. I'm sorry, I can't make head or tail of that. I'll admit it. It comes out of a major US university as well. The DODAF, Department of Defense Architecture Framework, is designed to provide correct and timely information to decision makers involved in future acquisitions of communications equipment. Now, the DODAF applies to the United States. What I'm going to show now have no intention of having it applied to anywhere outside the United States. And I'll say that now because it's a cartoon. But it's supposed to apply for communications equipment, and it's used to describe systems. It's supposed to apply to interfaces, making timely information involved in acquisitions of communications equipment so your system can talk to other systems. But it's being used to describe systems. And then when you've got 83 pages in the definitions, guidelines, and backgrounds, 249 pages of product descriptions, 256 pages in the desk book, the underlying data model has 696 pages and 1,200 data elements. Get real. How many people actually use this? It's legislated. Somebody actually wrote it up. They implemented a subset of it, and it took them 45,000 man hours to create. I mean, it's way too expensive. Now, in the DODAF, it has a number of views, an operational view, a system view, a technical view. Those of you who are familiar with the DODAF know that an OV1 describes the use of the system. Now, how is the DODAF used in reality? I'm going to have my friend Dilbert help me out on this. Here's the DODAF you asked for. I don't understand any of it. I can't tell if it's right or if it would embarrass me. I can't ask for a second opinion without looking stupid. And I can't distribute it because it might be wrong. I'll put it on this pile and hope that something changes. Should I shred your pile of indecision? Make it look like an accident. More linear thinking. If you look in the 5000 model, you've got a line here, evolution, acquisition, or single step full capability. Wait a minute, you can't do that. That doesn't show evolutionary acquisition, it still shows linear. And people don't read the small print. The small print talks about evolutionary, but the drawing is still linear. And you can't go single step to full capability and be evolutionary acquisition. Two are totally incompatible. And this is a February 2009 document you can download off the internet. Now, if we come back to changes, we need to teach change. Programs don't fail because the requirements change. The tasks, product, and processes for managing change exist and have done so for 20 years. Ever heard of configuration management? Works very well. Just don't use it. Programs fail because of poor requirements, change management, and the failure to evaluate the requirements over time because the needs change, the technology changes, and I've seen these published. But what also changes is the paradigm. World War II showed the effect of air power on battleships. But we've got another paradigm shift coming on today in terms of low-cost guided ordnance. When you get this billion-dollar aircraft go flying over a hill and half a dozen heads pop up with surface-to-air guided missiles and shoot at it, the plane won't be able to cope with that many coming in at the same time. We don't know what the effect is. Are we ignoring it? Spend a lot of money, lose a few pilots. So, let's try and take a look at what happened to systems engineering over the 60s and the 70s. And this is a framework I use for explaining it. There are five levels. These come from Derek Hitchens: product, system, business, supply chain, socioeconomic. And you can see that each one is a higher. Each one contains many of the others. Large-scale systems, they called in those days large-scale systems, and we had people working in systems. Now let's plot the standards on that drawing. 499, 1220, 15288. And so as a result of this, the proposed reference curriculum for systems engineering starts here. We're educating a group of systems engineers that don't know about this. Not a good situation for the future. What about that system of systems thing? Well, the Type 2 systems engineering process is in Layer 2. System of systems are in those areas there. Oh, we don't have a process for that. That's why we need to develop new tools and techniques. But you get some of the older systems engineers who've been in the business for years, where did they work in the entire area? They know about that, no problem. And what gets to be worse now is the words have different meanings. The words that we use in systems engineering have different meanings depending on which square you're in. The word capability in 3A means something different to capability in C2. And the word concept of operations or operations concept are used interchangeably, but they're not. One word is for one area and the other one is for the other area. Well, I think operations research might replace systems engineering, which is fine at NUS because you've got a Department of Operations Research as well. Systems engineering is advancing up from Layer 2 to tackle the problems in Layer 3. But it's trying to use a Type 2 process paradigm, which doesn't work in Layer 3. Operations research has been successfully solving these problems for years. Look at the definition of OR. It's concerned with the heart of this control problem, how to make sure that the whole system works with maximum effectiveness and least cost. Many modern systems engineers would apply this goal to systems engineering. Great big overlap there. Now if we look at model-based systems engineering, how many people here have heard model-based systems engineering? It's the latest fad in systems engineering. Here's the definition. Application of modeling to support systems requirements, design, analysis, verification, validation, activities, etc. in the life cycle. OR is the use of mathematical models, statistics, and algorithms to aid in decision making. Model-based systems engineering is an instance of class operations research when I speak object-oriented software language. So it's taken the systems engineers another 40 years to work back to developing the tools that they had in the 1960s. In conclusion, systems engineering, the systems approach works very well, the problems are not going away. The question is, who's going to provide the cost and effective solution? Systems engineering or something else? Systems engineering academia needs to get its act together to teach the right concepts to the right people. Blended learning technology is increasing competition, which means a student who wants to study systems engineering or anything can go to any university in the world. All they've got to do is to figure out how to pay for it. The university is as close as their computer. And customers are starting to set requirements. Navy did it, Boeing did it, Lockheed Martin did it for one course, for one module, back when I was at Maryland. It's happening. So, prescription for failure. Follow the DoD 5000 model. Where systems engineers are not allowed to do this. They do that, which isn't much systems engineering. Or change. Back on problems, the idea of change, alternative ways of accomplishing, common accepted basis for judging the value of the systems, performance, reliability, etc. Each of the system has its own environment and is in fact a subsystem of some broader systems. Stop messing around with system of systems and get to work. And computational and experimental techniques. When was this written? For those of you who can see the bottom of the screen, 1965. We've lost something over the years. So, how do we get them back? Well, here are my suggestions or recommendations. At systems engineer postgraduate degrees to meet the customer's requirements. Go back to the problem-solving paradigm. Introduce the paradigm of change. We know change is going to happen. Build it in. Deal with it. Focus on the people, not on the process. Create curriculum guidelines for teaching conditional knowledge. Modify our courses and modules to allow for early identification and production of type 3, 4s, and 5s. Create a body of knowledge. Well, that's happening. The NCOSI fellows have started to do it, and there was a paper submitted to the NCOSI symposium in July. So if you want to know what's happening about that, come to the symposium. Don't legislate, educate. Get rid of complexity, institutionalize simplicity. Let me explain a little bit about how we can do that. Space station, is that a complex system? Not a trick question. Yes. It's a complex system. Space shuttle, another complex system. But when we're dealing with the problem of docking one to the other, we abstract out everything except the relative positions, the relative velocity, and the relative alignment. So we deal with yaw and pitch. Bad pun takes me to pitch. Baseball pitch. When we're modeling the movement of a pitch in baseball, all we have to do is consider gravity, air resistance, velocity, and the spin of ball. We don't have to worry about these other things. Well, how do we learn that? From experience. We learn what to abstract out. But in our current systems engineering and the people dealing with complexity, we're making it more and more complex instead of making it simple. Remember Rube Goldberg's drawing? Well, one way to make a start is to require all graphics to comply with Miller's rule. George Miller, psychologist, said the human brain can handle 7 plus or minus 2 objects at one time. Let's make all our drawings limited to 9 objects at the most. It will make the graphics a lot more understandable. It'll make people who are drawing them have to think about what they're doing. they'll have to apply hierarchical decomposition at each level, which means they'll have to structure the subsystems in the hierarchical decomposition to minimize coupling, maximum cohesion, and self-organization. They'll abstract out the non-pertinent information, which is keep it simple, student. And there'll be no more cut and paste of these drawings and people unwilling to question them, so that these complex, unworkable, unrealistic drawings just pass through the system. So, I'll give you two options for the INCOSI International Symposium in the year 2020. Remember, look at alternatives. First option, if we don't do anything about it, systems engineering. We do something about it, we're providing whole optimal solutions to complicated problems in a type 5 paradigm. So I talked about the Seldon crisis, I talked about the systems approach is the way to go. The particular Seldon crisis gave you some observations on systems engineering, talked a little bit about the history and evolution of systems engineering, and gave you some recommendations. Any questions or comments?
I thought the V model is actually an attempt to try to decompose the complex system to simple system.
It is, but only for one go around the waterfall, not for the entire life cycle. When I was talking to Kevin Forsberg about it, the person who wrote the article, and I said, well, how did you come up with that? His comment was, he was talking to his customer, and his customer wanted some changes. So he was drawing the V model and showing the relationship between testing and development and testing. And then when the customer wanted changes, he sort of said, okay, you want some changes? He picked the drawing up off the wall, moved it down in time, and said, you start again here, and that's $10 million. That bit got forgotten. People look at the V and say, oh, right, we can turn that into a process. It's not. It's a relationship between functions. It's not a process. We created the V model for process in exactly the same way as we created those models from Blanchard. We took functions and turned it into a process without thinking. Anyone else?
What about system architecture? You mentioned it was more really a system where lots of other systems important as an architect.
That's the front-end system design. Yes, we use the word design in England and architecting in the United States. Back up in this area here, what this has become is go speak to the customer and figure out if the requirements are right. What this used to be in the 60s and the 70s was understand the problem, conceptualize alternative solutions. So it's design alternative architectures, pick the architecture, and then go ahead and write the requirements for a system that conforms to that functional architecture, which is then built in B, C, D, and E. You have to speak up, I can't hear you.
Okay. Two comments really. The first is the your view of the waterfall model. It also struck me from your comments of V that really you shouldn't put an element of time in it. It could very well, like a waterfall, show potential energy. It's very difficult to get from this level. It's easy to get from the top to the bottom, but it takes more effort to get from a lower level to a higher level. Maybe.
Well, no, you don't. You never go from the lower level to the higher level in the same drawing. If you think about it, you have.
So the arrows don't really show. It could not necessarily show time, but show amount of effort needed to go from a lower level to a higher level.
But
it's possible.
You don't do that. You keep going down. You ever seen, if I draw this as a Gantt chart,
see, the assumption is you put a dimension of time in there. Well, that's causality. In fact, you put an element of causality inside that diagram, which need not necessarily be so.
So, is it looking at functions, or is it looking at time?
It need not be at time either. Basically, you shouldn't put time in there.
But we do.
Okay, so I agree with you that you don't have to put time, but your criticism of the... this diagram was based on time.
It is based on time. If it's just used to show functions and relationship, but then it's not designed for that. The waterfall model is basically when you're sitting at the front of the waterfall and you're looking down into the future, these are the activities that you plan. Build a little Tesla loop. And so you end up, if you look at the way the project should be, you can consider it as a V here, a V here, a V here, a V there, or a little waterfall here, a little waterfall there, a little waterfall there, a little waterfall there. That's the spiral.
Okay, and then I'm going to take you up on this, what you titled your talk as, the Seldon crisis. So in the Seldon crisis, there's an internal conflict, which is probably afflicting, as I would say, the systems engineering community. Right, there's a crisis in the systems engineering community. And then there's an external dilemma, which is the pressures that are being put on by people outside of this community on the systems engineering community. And I gather that it could be that the outside society looks to systems engineers to solve complex problems. Am I right?
Right.
And the solution to that is somewhere in your slide about producing type 5 engineers. So that's the last part of a Seldon crisis, is that the solution solves both things at the same
correct,
time.
Correct, because when you have the basic problems in systems engineering, trying to understand the difficulties and the differences between the roles, the functions, system of systems, complex systems, once you've got type 5s, who are looking at it from the problem-solving perspectives, that all goes away.
Okay. The issue I have is that, first of all, I don't think society is looking to engineers to solve problems, per se. They are not looking to engineers to solve all of their problems, because there are many ways of looking at systems. Your particular way is looking at systems from a very functionalist point of view. In other words, function meaning that it has inputs, outputs, it's out to, has a purpose, and so on. But there are other ways of looking at systems. In fact, the very early systems thinkers point to the fact that, well, there is the biological way of looking at systems, meaning that a system has the will to create, recreate itself, and the will to survive. If you look at a system that way, it's got totally different properties from a functional system. And then there are the organizational management people who look at a system as a group of intense agents with intentions. If you look at it that way, again, the system has totally different properties. So, and finally, there's another group of people who look at systems as political processes. So nothing about functions in there at all. So systems engineering has a particularly simplifying way of looking at systems, and I don't think that's appropriate for the real world. Because many of the failures that you point to about the Air Force, and then, yes, they were technical systems, but embedded within very much other things that were going on in the real world. And you cannot say that this technical process is a subsystem of some other system. No. I think they are more operating as, from a network point of view, a system of systems. So those are my points.
I agree with you. And if you go back to, where is it? The one on, we'll get there eventually. Michael Jackson Keane's how far back was it?
About complex systems, I think.
Yeah.
Michael Jackson's
there we go.
People die, no? Talks about
You're talking about different methodologies. Yes. And a good systems engineer will know enough about the different methodologies to know which one to use in which particular situation. But we don't teach that.
There are different way of representing systems. The way you represent the system is by piecing together functional blocks. Right? But there are other ways of representing the system.
Yes. They are, and I just, because I only have an hour, I mean, you want to talk about this for a week?
Have you researched into value-based systems engineering? As opposed to the model-based system engineering that you call it?
Yeah. Systems engineering is all about producing value.
Exactly.
Modeling is just a tool.
So what I mean is there's another way of looking at system engineering, which is values. Yeah. Which I believe brings up a different dimension in system engineering, which can avoid the Seldon crisis that you mentioned just.
I sure hope so.
Hopefully.
We have to learn to use all these methodologies when they're appropriate. If we use the wrong methodology, we don't end up with success. We need the people who are smart enough to know which methodology to use. And then what usually happens is you don't use a textbook methodology as is. You have to take a little bit of this methodology, a little bit of that methodology, and create something that you use to solve the problem. Or fix the situation, or do something about the situation. Maybe I shouldn't say solve the problem. Make a change. Okay. Anyone else?
So, how do you teach such 3, 4, and 5? And why are the universities not doing it?
Ask people in the universities. It's very difficult because we're so used to teaching type 2s that it's very difficult to change. We need to switch the whole focus of the questions. And also, you need brave professors to do this, because as long as you're teaching procedural and declarative knowledge, your evaluations are high. The moment you start teaching conditional knowledge to students who are not used to it, your evaluations go down.
But they do that a lot in the business school. They teach a lot of conditional knowledge. And they get very high evaluation. Business school professors get very high evaluation.
So we need to learn how they do it, because we don't do it in engineering.
But I think that another reason is because it took so long for system engineering to be recognized as a discipline. Because it's always seen as a softer side and doesn't qualify as an engineering discipline. And therefore, it's very difficult for them now to go into conditional, teaching conditional knowledge again, where it seems to be, appear to be soft.
They took all the hard out. All those mathematical techniques. Most of them apply in column A. You take column A out of systems engineering, there's no math. I'll admit I have not used any math since I came out of college, other than to figure out students' results on exams. But what we also don't teach is when we teach those tools, the mathematical techniques, we don't teach the students as to which is the appropriate tool. We don't teach the students to question how accurate an answer do you want, how quickly, because that will determine which mathematical approach you use. Any question?
What should the book of knowledge based on conditional knowledge look like?
That's a good question. The book of knowledge, the knowledge should be a set of requirements. So it would be understand vagueness, or deal with vagueness. But then we're not looking for knowledge, we're looking for characteristics.
Yeah, because by definition, book knowledge is something where the wisdom, they are collected in Singapore.
Yeah.
But your definition, your
Well, actually, there are two ways to look at it. There, you can write the book of knowledge as a requirement, in which it says you need, for example, in the book of knowledge on systems engineering, the word requirements does not show up. Oops, why doesn't it show up? Because a requirement is a design that meets a requirement of communicating something. And you can communicate that something with drawings or models. Requirements that are a text mode way of communicating something to the people who are going to build or test the system. So the knowledge is communication of what needs to be built. So that's what shows up in the book of knowledge at the high level. If you then take a look at a design, like a degree, and you look at the knowledge that's being taught in each of the modules, then you'll see requirements, models. And you trace back those requirements back to the book of knowledge, which says these are ways of communicating.
In fact, besides knowledge, students, I think, need to understand that there are different kinds of problems, broad classifications of problems. The ones that we teach in engineering are usually structured thinking problems. Yeah. They fit into a mold. And so we teach them how to solve those problems very efficiently. That's one type of problem. And then there are the complex problems, which are actually interrelated chain problems. And then there are messes, which really is, and then finally there are wicked problems, which really have no solution at all. So trying to apply systems engineering to some of these other kinds of problems is a recipe for failure.
Yes, what we teach in systems engineering class are layer two. In layer two, we already know what it is we're going to build. So it's mechanistic. The problems are all closed. Do we use transistors or valves, as it was a few years ago? Or do we do it this way or that way? When we're up here in the higher levels, we're dealing with less structured problems. Sort of the higher you go up in the layers, the less structured the problems are. And that you need different tools and methodologies to work with them.
And I would argue that at least I try to engage the philosophers, the Department of Philosophy, because these problem-solving methods have been with us through human history. For example, with wicked problems, it's really a clash of values and ways of seeing a world. And so there's no way around you cannot negotiate the problem. It's basically a direct clash of how two sets of people see the same world.
Actually, a wicked problem is the first stage in the scientific method. You know what the scientific method is? Trial and error. Except we don't teach it that way. You observe something, you try and understand what's going on. You say, okay, I think I know how it works. I'll do an experiment. If the experiment works, then okay, I got that right. I understand it. The experiment didn't work, back to the drawing board and try again.
So because in the real world, like the Afghan war or the war in Iraq, that's a real wicked problem. Your opponent or whoever other stakeholders are not going to allow you trial and error.
No, but the wicked misunderstand.
Allow you the scientific method.
You misunderstand. The wicked problem is the first stage of the scientific method when you're trying to figure out what you need, when you're trying to understand it to figure out what you can do to solve it. And because it shows up as a wicked problem, it means you haven't gone up, you're not looking at it properly. Now, whether you need a helicopter view or whether you need a different view to look at it to figure out what the problem really is, I don't know. It means it's a recognition that we are looking at it the wrong way or we're not looking at it the right way.
And then the widget problems are distinguished from masses. Masses is a question of priority. So that means both sets of people see the world in roughly the same way, but they've got their priorities not aligned properly. So by negotiation, we can probably work out win-win, yeah, compromise, some kind of thing.
That's right.
So recognizing the problem is the first stage.
Yes.
What kind of a problem it is the first step.
And that's what happens here. That was the basic tenet of systems engineering in the 1965s, in the 60s and the 70s. Systems engineering didn't start with a set of requirements. Although, mind you, when I was taking courses in Maryland at 1998, that's when I first started doing coursework in my doctorate degree, my instructor in systems engineering, who had worked on electronic warfare, he said systems engineering started for him when he was given a set of requirements. He was my instructor, so I didn't argue. Anyone else? Yeah.
I'm just wondering, because you mentioned that system engineers have different categories, and it seems that for me, it seems like an evolutionary process where you gain experience and you go from progress from one stage to the other. And so you seem to recommend that that through courses we can actually seek to develop category 3, 4, and 5 kind of system engineers. I'm just wondering, is it something realistic or maybe within the scope for curriculum?
Well, in my classes, when I use a little bit of these techniques, I can see who the type 2s are and who the type 3s and 5s might be. So there are ways to identify potential type 5s, because you can't train this person in the classroom. It needs the experience component as well. But it might be possible to identify people who have a high probability of becoming 5 years later, 10 years later, type 5s, and fast track them through the organization. And that would be a great benefit.
So Joel, in other words, you're saying that currently, our editing system is actually adequate in the sense that we can still produce type 5 and system engineers.
We're producing type...
Provided that we can identify them.
I didn't hear that.
No, but from the answer just now, because actually we do have a number of courses or curriculum, especially in the capstone project, immersing our students in real-world problem over 2 semesters, right? And they are dealing with the supply chain type of problem, dealing with non-industry sectors.
Yeah, I've been using those projects for years, but it seems to me that in systems engineering, and I've seen this in other courses taught by other people, we're dealing with postgraduate students, some of whom have worked in systems engineering and some haven't. If they come into the course or the module knowing systems engineering, they come out knowing it. If they come in not knowing it, they come out of it not knowing it slightly less. Somehow,
you should be here longer.
They're not getting it, so I need to figure out, improve the way I teach. Ask my students, they'll tell you. Any more? Well, if you have any other questions over time, my email and phone number are published, and I can give you a card.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for spending exactly 1 hour 30 minutes here. Before you leave, there'll be a lot more interesting topics like this, especially when you turn up at the INCOSI 209 July. Over 4 days, 100 over topics of presentation plus another 40 to 50 poster exhibitions. So there's a wide range of topics available. The online registration starts in about 2 or 3 days' time. So there are still brochures here, there's still brochures on the table outside. Pick some up and distribute them with to your friends and try and help us publicize it. Yeah, there's still brochures outside the table. Yes, certainly. There's still coffee and tea and cold water outside the table. So help yourself as you leave here.
And I just want to say that this IS09 will earn you 32 credit for your BDU. So if you are CSAT, that means 2 years of your registration is fulfilled.
Thank you very much again. Thank you. Thank you.